There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. You want it darker? We kill the flame. They're lining up the prisoners and the guards are taking aim. I struggled with some demons, they were middle class and tame. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? Hey, nay, 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 I'm ready, my lord.
Bloody greetings, Slashaholics. Be sure to check out the merch store. The link is in the description below. You'll find several designs, any type of item you can think of. You pick the size, color, shape, whatever, and it's shipped out to you very quickly. Be sure to use the promo code 10OFF at checkout for 10% off your purchase. Just click that link for the merch store in the description below, and you'll be supporting the channel and walking around in slasher style. Tonight's upload is brought to you by our patrons on the Patreon page. That's Alleyway, Bonanza Jellybean, Bree, Carl Eakins, Cecilia Spears, Allison Sive, Hawaii, Iron Alexa, Catherine McClear, Kai Antez, Ryan Woodward, Shawn Campbell, Liam Anderson, and TikTok 12. Thank you all so much for supporting the channel and keeping it going and growing for years to come. And if anyone listening right now would like to support this channel and help it keep going, please click on the Patreon link in the description below. You can sign up for as low as $2 to $5 per month. You get some great rewards, early access to certain slasher content, some of the stuff you can get, free merch from the merch store, free ebooks emailed to you. You can actually get voice roles and audiobook narrations, guest roles on the podcast, and so much more, depending on the tier you select. Check it out. You can also find links in the description below for the 80 Slasher Librarian YouTube channel's Twitter, Facebook, and Reddit pages.
Good evening, Slashaholics. This is Shawn Campbell back with the 80 Slasher Librarian, Josh LaRue, for episode 4 of our podcast, Out of Print Slashers. How you doing tonight, Josh?
Doing pretty good. And you want to tell them what book we're talking about tonight?
Tonight we are going to be talking about Friday the 13th. Hell Lake by Paul A. Woods. This is one of the Black Flame novels. This particular one was released in 2005, but if you'll remember with these Black Flame novels, they're the ones that were kind of mandated to be around 400 pages. There's kind of mixed reviews on each of these, but they're all part of the same series. Funny enough, I think it's interesting that each of the covers of these books, they all feature the Kane Hodder Jason from the beginning of Jason X. That's the one. It's like he did a photo shoot and they took like six stills and then just like made one the cover of each book.
All but the Jason strain, right? Because that one's Ken Kersinger, isn't it? From Freddy vs. Jason?
That one might be. That's not in the collage picture I have for the series.
Yeah, because I remember that being weird. It's like they used Kane for like the first four books and then all of a sudden it's Ken Kersinger. Maybe like the Freddy vs. Jason book came out between those or something. I don't know. I don't know the order they were published, but I mean, I know the order that these five Jason books were. I know that, but I don't know when like the novelization of Freddy vs. Jason came out compared to these five books and the Jason X books.
Yeah, it's been really difficult to try to find any behind the scenes information on these, trivia. I mean, it's hard to just find the books in general.
I was going to tell you, did you know we have a sponsor now?
Oh, no, I didn't.
Yeah, tonight's podcast episode is brought to you by the Lament Configuration. Solving this puzzle box will be a pleasure. All right, let's talk some Hell Lake, man. I've been looking forward to this one.
Yeah, so at the beginning of this book, it features a man named Wayne Sanchez, and he's being executed. And when he dies, he goes to hell. He goes to, like, the 13th circle of hell, but he's stuck there.
And the 13th circle. 13th.
He's with every killer apparently that's ever died. They're just in a pit, just hanging out, and he really wants to get out. And he's smack talking with a bunch of people, and they kill each other, and they end up back in the circle. And I guess that's hell. And
how did you picture it? Because the way I pictured it was like this, just like almost like blackness with no outer edge, right? And it's kind of like a wilderness, but it's in the dark constantly. The way he didn't really give a solid description, you know, he was all over the place with his imagery on what hell looked like.
I just pictured like a prison yard where they kind of walk in a circle, but it's like a cave. So it's a bunch of people just wandering around in circles, and
yeah.
Occasionally you can find another rock to sit on. Like, and he said there at one point, he said there was like no space. Then he said there was like enough space to find sitting places with apparently millions of dead killers. I don't know.
I don't know. Wow. But there's only one killer that he is interested in finding.
And we find him kind of like in that 2003 Hulk movie where they tried to stop the Hulk by shooting him with foam, and he was kind of like in this foam ball. That's how I pictured Jason when they said he's just kind of embedded in a boulder.
Yeah, I know. Oh, my God. With a tear in his eye. Can't forget the tear in his eye.
And apparently Wayne Sanchez has been a big fan of Jason. Kind of thought he was a legend, but he's a big, big fan. And he's like, yo, you're my main man. Let's be partners. Let's break out of hell. You know, I think we can go up. I think so. He leads a revolution out of hell.
We can't forget the smart ass that he comes across on his way to Jason, though.
Ooh, I was gonna touch on that later when I touch in the
okay.
Kindness.
Okay, but yeah, he plays a pretty big part whenever Sanchez is on his way looking for Jason. But yeah, so
we can talk about that guy now because you know, there's a lot of positives and negatives about this book, but if I'm going to say a positive, they run into this, I guess, ex-lawyer in hell named Charles, and he's kind of quoting philosophy from different books about all the different types of hells, and it seems like they're in a hell that's not really the norm, and it's like for all of his, you know, philosophy and high thinking doesn't change the fact they're still stuck there. So they each kind of show a different, you know, side of evil, I guess you could say. So they're kind of like an unwilling team.
And he's like this sophisticated, preppy Southern guy, you know, almost like Father Long in a way, but more fucked up. Father Long from Church of the Divine Psychopath. He's kind of a smartass to Sanchez. I'm surprised Sanchez didn't just kill him there in that first scene with him. But yeah, there's a whole scene between them when Sanchez is on his way to find Jason. But hey, once he finds Jason, guess what, everybody? Jason has a new best friend. You heard it here first. Jason Voorhees has a best friend in this book.
And Jason cried a tear of, I guess, happiness.
Yes.
Yeah.
It happens. I gotta say, before we get too far into it, this is not a horrible book. It's actually a great Escape from Hell book, you know, but it feels like the author found out about the 25th anniversary thing they were doing with the books and was like, hey, I can get my book published. I'll just write Jason into this book.
And by the way,
I'm saying that's how it happened.
We don't know this for a fact. This is just our speculation.
Yeah, it's speculation. That's what it feels like.
Saying that we know that.
Because, hey, I like the book. I really did. It was a good book. It was just a very strange take on Jason. You're definitely not going to be bored with this book. I'll tell you that. Even if you hate it, you're going to keep reading it just to see what happens next.
But I will say at a few parts, you will forget Jason's in this book.
Yes, yes. That's why I feel like he was shoehorned in, but that's just my speculation. So, I'm going to let Shawn here tell you how they prison break hell.
It's kind of, I guess they just go up. It sounds like they just find, I guess, a hole in the ceiling or something, and they kind of pile on top of each other, and they go through, and they end up breaking into all the circles of hell until they shoot straight up out of Crystal Lake and they just disperse all over the world, going and killing and maiming and doing whatever they do best. But that's not how it's written.
Yeah. But first, they escape from hell before they escape from hell. Because it's like a Quentin Tarantino type thing with this whole escaping hell situation. Because like one scene, you're sitting here reading about Sanchez trying to get everybody fired up and Jason fired up to escape. And then all of a sudden, we meet our cast of human characters who were at it. Go ahead.
I was just saying the two main characters, Trey and Shauna, and all of their college friends.
Yes, and they're at a party. And don't forget Christoph's, the little weirdo. At a party. And what was the music? ICP? It was ICP, right?
I think it was.
Yeah, it was like some ICP song. And they're like, yeah, ICP, man. Which I was into ICP as a teenager. it was just weird.
You got to give them props for that, though. They're having a party at Crystal Lake in January. Because we've never seen Jason in the snow. But they don't really address any snow in this. So I pictured snow.
With a little bit of ice on the lake. But yeah, just right in the middle of this party, all hell breaks loose. Like literally, they break loose from hell. These killers are there. And then the next scene, we're back in hell and they're getting ready to do the breakout. And it's confusing. But when you look at it like a Quentin Tarantino type thing, like a Pulp Fiction type thing, it makes sense what he's trying to do there. But it was just weird in written form and weird trying to narrate it. Cause I was like, people are going to think I'm reading this out of order, you know? Even I was a bit confused.
I mean, people are getting killed, and the cops arrest people, and they're trying to do an investigation, and then you find out later, like, they don't know who's killing, but you're like, you know who kills, because it's the people that escaped from hell, but you don't know that yet,
And they haven't escaped yet? It's so weird. Some cool kills in that scene, don't you agree there?
Oh, yeah, and another prop for starting this book, it's not Crystal Lake. It's Forest Green. Back in Friday the 13th, Part 6, they changed Crystal Lake to Forest Green so they could start reopening the camp, and they changed the name of the town to kind of wave off the Crystal Lake killing. So now it's Forest Green, Camp Forest Green. I thought that was really cool because Part 6 was like one of the best Friday the 13ths.
Oh, yeah, one of my favorites for sure.
Yeah, I mean, this book kind of seemed like a lot of Hellraiser, you know? Like, they're lamenting being stuck in hell. They're all in their private, torture, and they try to escape. And they definitely could have put some Cenobites in here. That would have been interesting.
Yeah, very Hellraiser-esque for sure, man. I got that vibe. That was in your notes, but that's something I thought, too.
This is kind of different. It was kind of like a mental torture. Like, none of the guys were getting tortured in hell.
I know, right?
Yes. Like, a lot of them were just bored. Like they're in a waiting room. Like I'm picturing, like, the waiting room from Beetlejuice or something, where they're all just reading magazines, like, just waiting for their chance to get out.
Right. We told you about it, about Jason finding a best friend. And we'll make that the first clip. So here is Sanchez whenever he first meets Jason Voorhees in hell. Wayne Sanchez guessed that he'd better try to disentangle from their bodies and find himself a space of his own. It wasn't going to be easy. The further he pushed his way into the center of the circle, the more expansive the mass of damned humanity seemed, the greater the illusion of endlessness. Here, where the echoing tunnels belched out cold bursts of fear, the big bad devil boy quietly confessed to himself that he felt more scared and scary. The cavernous floor was uneven beneath his feet. If he looked to check whether he was on an upward slope or an incline, he might be carried away by the swaying masses that surrounded him. All he could do was to fight his way through, to make use of his natural belligerence. Sometimes he lost his footing, but learned to use it as a cue to vault forward, to push his way through those who stumbled or fell in front of him. He also learned to summon up his inner demons. He still had the spirit, and to all extent the body of a young man. Where some fool wouldn't permit him any breathing space, then a punch below the belt or a thumb in the eye would remove that obstacle until he pushed forward into another wave of damned souls. He learned quickly, in hell there is no mutual cooperation. You have to fight dirty or go under. And so it went on. Wayne didn't know whether he'd been roaming the circles for hours or days by the time he first set eyes on a few feet of empty living space. Except that empty wasn't really the term. Over by a cluster of bulbous rock formations, like something that had been dredged up from some forsaken seabed, sat a huge, seemingly still figure. It immediately inspired something like awe, not only in Sanchez, but in every lost soul around him. No one would approach within several feet of the blue-gray rocks, for fear of intruding on the creature's privacy. And creature seemed to be the operative word, for something that was either a little more or a little less than human. Its bulk, tied up and contained in a sharpless, jerkin and sweat top that smelled like they hadn't been changed in a decade or more, moved only slightly, imperceptibly, his chest falling and rising slowly with every breath. Sanchez had been made. The big freak had seen him, turning his head to stare at the intruder who dared come too close. He should have backed off, but for the first time since he'd fallen through the 13 circles of hell, he was captivated. What had seemed, in the dark distance, to be a distorted, featureless face was actually a mask, wide enough to cover most of the wearer's massive head. It was stark white, though dirtied by age, with vertical grid holes cut for the eyes and mouth, like an old-fashioned hockey player's mask. It was then that the Devil Boy became convinced he was looking on the near-mythical, indestructible force of hate that was Jason Voorhees. Maybe he had lost his mind after all. Maybe hell wasn't so much a place as a state of mind. Maybe hell was madness. Wayne Sanchez remembered the stories in the schoolyard that all the nice kids would bring back from summer camp. He had no time for all their mommy and daddy says crap, and he never stuck around much after fourth grade anyhow. Once his own daddy took off and mommy farmed him out to his fucked up old witch of a grandma and whatever parasite lover she'd taken in at the time. But he was enthralled to eavesdrop on all their stories about Jason, about Camp Blood, and about all the poor little teenage cuties that got sliced and diced there. About how the bloodbath was supposedly started by Jason's mom, before she got off and her little boy took over. How the murders spread out from the Hicksville town where they first took place, whilst with sightings of Jason, the deformed butcher in the mask, as far away as New York City. All the stories about how the sucker had been stabbed, shot, run through by harpoon guns, drowned, generally kicked in the ass, folded, spindled, mutilated, but had never been killed. So it was most likely a crock. So what? People believe what they want to believe. Jason was like the retarded kid who became almost as all-powerful as Satan. The persecuted freak boy who showed them who he was by slashing throats and cutting off the heads of every motherfucker who came his way. As Sanchez had grown older, the media used words like folklore and modern myth to describe the Voorhees legend. Wayne didn't care. Jason was someone he wanted to believe in. He mentally filed away every last Shaggy Dog story. He even watched some of the dumb movies they made about him. By the time he was waiting on the row, he would plague the guards to tell him about any crime reports from Hicksville, California, where it looked like there might be any murders attributable to the man behind the mask. The guards thought he was nuts, too. Jason Voorhees was a yarn that simply couldn't be true. It was like trying to attribute the Night Stalker murders to Bigfoot. So fuck them, what did they know? Sanchez thought. Here he was, stuck in some nightmare world at the very end of his own existence. And who was looking right back at him from behind that legendary mask? The big hulk started a little as Wayne moved forward. Hey, it's okay. I know who you are. I heard a shitload about you, S.A. He could see one eye behind the mask, the right eye. It was like a big cow's eye, regarding him with curiosity. Sanchez knew the story about how the kid's head had been deformed, how Jason had been an outcast in childhood, because his face had the symmetry of something painted on a balloon by a drunk, and he sympathized, not only for the poor rejected kid, but for the revenge he'd taken on the world he hated. The Devil Boy sympathized as much with the crimes as with the perpetrator. A nail through an eye, the socket demolished, the jelly of the split eyeball spilling onto the cheek, a double puncture with a spear gun, some fool and his coup speared through the guts,
joining them hip to hip as they screwed. A body cut clean in two. The sucker dangling from the rafters in two halves. His sausage-like gut spilling from his exposed lower half, revealing his vital organs, his kidneys. Sanchez reeled back. His mind was often filled with violence. But these sudden flashes had come to him like a bolt out of nowhere. In this dark place, the bright color of blood illuminated his world. It shocked him out of the despondency he was sinking ever more deeply into. It made him smile. The silent giant behind the hockey mask regarded him curiously, cocking his head as if he were one of the more highly intelligent mammals, but still not quite human. "That was you. You did that, didn't you, amigo?" Sanchez didn't fully know why, but he felt like laughing and weeping at the same time. Jason was showing him a way out of this place, even if it was just by giving him a full-color peep show of a different kind of hell. "You're sharing your memories with me." One tear trickled out of the corner of the devil boy's eye. Maybe he was imagining things, but he thought he might be seeing moisture in that bovine eye behind the mask, too.
Aw, isn't that so sweet, Shawn? So well, sweet.
Gonna happen someday.
So, yeah. So the killers, everybody in hell, they pretty much just go through all the different circles of hell, killing everybody in their path. Which you would think when they kill them, they would kill them and they just pop right back up in hell and they'd have to kill them again. But no. And you find out that it was them that escaped through the lake and killed the kids at the party. And this is where things get interesting because these killers, hell, one of them finds a job almost immediately, Mr. Westenhouse. And Jason has the ability to teleport just by being mentioned.
Yeah, so people would be in the middle of a kill, and then Jason would appear, but then he would see that they're indecent, and he would just kind of kill everyone. It was really odd.
There were some hardcore kills in this book, like the shower kill.
Yeah,
that one was hardcore.
And what gets me is that the cops are so. I've never seen such racist cops. These are like super racist. Not only
worse than Jason being racist in the novelization of part 3.
Yeah, I didn't know what to think about racist Jason. That was just weird, especially him hiding behind curtains. But
the Michael Avalon version. All right, go ahead. We'll talk about that one when we get there. But yeah, these cops were pretty racist. Go ahead.
Yeah, like they're racist. They only arrest the minorities, and then when the kills happen with the exact MO in another state, they're like, "Oh no, it's these guys." It's like, this room was locked from the outside and the inside. There was no possible way.
It was them.
Like, yeah, it's them.
And that's all conjecture. It was them.
I just,
you know,
that is just.
Oh my God.
Yeah, but it was weird because like Jason and Sanchez were soul bonded in this book, but at a certain point, Sanchez just says the hell of it and just goes and drives to a different state, and then all the killers.
I know, right?
Back to where they were killing before they died.
And then he gets him a new best friend. I mean, we'll get there. But where we're at in the story pretty much right now is all these killings have happened. Everybody's being, like, pretty much quarantined at the college, correct?
Yeah.
At this point in the story. And they think they're safe there. And I got to talk about this goth couple because this book, I think, was, like, the fifth or sixth book I narrated on the channel. So whenever you listen to it, there's not going to be, like, musical cues and sound effects like there is in the more recent books, but it's still something you should definitely listen to because it's the most interesting Jason book you're probably ever going to read or listen to. It's so different. But there's this scene with this goth couple, and I can't believe that I didn't catch this and it ended up left in the narration. They have a sex scene. And boy, oh boy, John, the way this sex scene was written. And because they're doing this, somehow them having premarital sex and something they're watching on TV, Jason appears because something was mentioned about him and they're having premarital sex. He teleports through this TV. Yes, you're hearing that correctly. Jason teleports into the room from the television. He can do that since he's been to hell and back. And he proceeds to kill this goth couple with a giant crucifix, like a gothic crucifix. And that's not what got me. That's not what threw me off. And I can't believe I left this in there, but I'm going to play a clip of it. What's that?
You're like, that's neither here nor there.
It talks about how an orgasm is the little death. And as they're dying...
In French.
Yeah. What was it called?
In French, it's le petit mort. So I think it's how it's pronounced, but...
Yeah, so it's talking about that, and it says, as they're experiencing le petit mort, they're also experiencing the small death and the big death at the same time. And you just hear me, and I really didn't realize I did this. It's like, oh, geez, or something. So I'm going to play that clip for you right now just so you can hear it. That's something that really stood out to me in the story. Is that cool with you, Shawn? Throw that clip in there?
Is it worth it?
All right. Here we go. La petite...
...known this was working for him, but she didn't want it to happen just now. Close your eyes and think of oblivion, she whispered to him, but he couldn't relax anymore. Who put that splatter movie on the VCR? Oh, what now? Had someone recorded over her tape of The Hunger? Lisa didn't want to slow up the action, for Christ's sake. Grinding over him again and again, she slowly turned her head toward the source of his gripe. He was right. She was just as pissed as he was to see, not Deneuve in the shower with the besotted Susan Sarandon or Bowie attacking some kid on the streets once his vampire years were up and he started to age, but instead, Jason Voorhees. Lumpish, misshapen, ugly, inarticulate, sexless, violent Jason Voorhees, the mindless non-entity behind that stupid mask, bloody pawed and lumbering toward the screen. Ignore it. Keep going. Don't stop now. Lisa turned her back to the screen, but sex and death were about to become more intertwined than she had ever known. Without a word, without a sound, their conjoining in the consciousness of these two young people had invited an intruder into their sanctum. A violent force of nature that had no need of announcing itself, had no need or doors or portals anymore, would no longer need to smash its hideous bulk through wooden partitions or glass windows. Now, one stray thought was enough to summon his unwelcome presence. No! No! Oh, God, no! Lisa kept the weight of her rump fastened to her boyfriend. Don't stop now, James! Not now! Locked into her sensual dream, she never saw what James saw. With her back turned to all else but this bed of sensual delights, she would never really know death until she faced it. The splintered wooden crucifix tore through the rear of her lungs with all the power a once human being could muster. Measuring 3 feet by 2 feet, its mighty ornate scale ripped most of her upper body apart. Its spiked head erupted diagonally through the midsection of her breast, tearing one loose from its fatty tissue. It pinned the screaming James to the bed, impaling him through the soft flesh at the top of his breastplate and the bottom of his throat. By the time Lisa knew what was happening to her, it was too late to act or to care. She breathed in sobs, but it was with the agony of respiration rather than weeping. James squirmed below her, the blood flowing from his gushing throat down the wooden shaft just an inch or two, before it found its viscous resting place in Lisa's hair. Jason filled James' vision, a nightmare from the screen become reality. He grunted a mighty breath, the sole triumphant bellow of a mute. He brought his weight, his force, his strength down hard once more, and the lovers were truly conjoined in death. With her face involuntarily kissing his bloody breast, Lisa shivered. Her chill warned her, almost reassured her that death was coming now. As she died, James's shaking body could control its involuntary spasms no longer, and at last he reached an orgasm that was concealed between her dead thighs. The little death flowed into the big death. Sex and death were as one. Jeez. When the early morning news hit Channel 8 at 5:30 a.m.
There you go. Oh, jeez.
Yeah. I think the line that got me in the beginning of the book, where it's like, I think a couple, one of them gets their head cut off, and it was like, as her head rolled off, it was apparent they would not be a perfect match. And I'm like, oh, shit.
Yes. Definitely some strange writing, but again, it's not, I can't tell if it's good cheese or bad cheese, because the book entertained me, you know? It's not like Death Moon where it was work to narrate it. I couldn't wait to get back to this each time to see what was next. I might have complained some in my commentary at the end of the chapters, but because it's like part of me knew that people were going to be like, what the fuck is he reading? You know, I knew some people were going to be like, what the hell is this? But it's, you know, it's different. It's different for sure. So
it's a hell of a lot smoother than Death Moon. I mean, this one, like you said, it's a weird Jason book, but it still is a good read. But Death Moon was choppy. It seems like six authors wrote it. I couldn't navigate through that one.
I think some of the pages in that book, he just had to fill in with random words. But that's going to be an episode all its own. Oh, boy. That one's coming one day. So there we are. The killings, they find out they're not safe in the college, you know, even quarantining away from all the killers because the killers can teleport. And
weird, because if they can teleport, why are they stealing cars? It's like, do they just get one teleport? Like, you get one
because car.
One guy went to Florida. The other ones are like, hey, there's a college over here. Cool. Teleport. Okay, now you got to get a car.
And all you got to do is think about them, and they're there, you know? So,
I don't know why all the serial killers are obsessed with these college kids. I mean, every other serial killer just drove to a completely different state.
But because Jason didn't stick around to answer any questions from the cops, we end up with more cops thinking somebody else is doing the killing. And we end up with a pretty crazy scene at the jail.
Yeah, I mean, that actually would have been cool to see in the movie, just all the killers kind of popping up, so they just kind of have a brawl where the college kids have to learn to defend themselves. And there actually is a good scene where Trey is actually starting to teach karate moves to the other kids, and the other kids are finding and making weapons. So that would have been really cool. That's a fortification we haven't really seen in the movies. You know, we haven't seen a lot of the heroes. I mean, usually it's like the final person will go up against Jason, but it's not the all the friends, and that's something you can do in a book that you can't do in a movie. There's the massive amounts of just normal people that don't want to die.
Very Dream Warriors-esque, but in a Jason story. You know, getting everybody, you know, trying to become a badass, getting ready for this fight that they know is going to... Because there's nowhere to run, you know. They're not being allowed to leave town, so... And the cops aren't believing anything they're saying. So it's going to come down to this. And these characters are likable for the most part. We haven't touched on Christos much, but Trey and Shauna, you know, I really like those characters. But yeah, like Trey and Shauna, I really actually like those characters. We had likable characters in this book. And you're right, you know, they were working together, you know. A couple of the characters, you know, you got your token people that are like, this ain't real or whatever. But for the most part, these characters were likable, and you were a little bit invested in them too.
Yeah, and you can relate to them. That this is a hard situation. Even if you are tough, even if you know how to fight, I mean, they take this nonstop for days after the killers came out of the lake. Just they don't really get a rest, mentally, physically, emotionally.
And people they know dropping like flies. And then the whole jail scene, you know, they're like in this situation that's like, there's no way out of it. You know, we have to fight or we're going to die. And there is some death in that scene.
But it could always be worse because the gloves are coming off, the hockey mask is coming off, and the welding mask is coming on. Yep, Jason has thrown away his iconic tools. You want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, so there's a scene where Jason sees a welder's mask and decides that he would rather wear that. It's one of them black welder masks that you can like flip the front of it up, and Jason decides he likes that better. And for the rest of the book, at least for most of the rest of the book, that's what Jason has, is a welder's mask, a black welder's mask.
And he picks up his machete.
Yep. In this jail scene here, which I'm going to play a clip of so you can hear it for yourself so you don't think I'm just bullshitting you here, because this really happens in the book. Jason needs a weapon. And the book talks about how he's conjuring up a weapon from his memory. Oh, yeah, he can conjure up things, like in his hands, and just make it appear.
Grand Theft Auto.
What's that?
Just like Grand Theft Auto.
Yeah, so he... Exactly. So he conjures up something from memory, and I think it even references one of the movies or something. And he conjures up a hunting rifle. Not to hit people with or bludgeon them to death with, mind you, but to shoot them with, and shoot them he does. And he gets shot. And he gets shot in two places. What are those places, Sean?
He gets shot in the ass. And he gets shot in his happy place.
Little Jason.
Yeah, little Jason.
Yes, little Jason gets shot, and he gets shot in the anus. And
he cries out in fury.
Yes, he cries out and screams in fury. You know what? Clip time. Here's a clip of everybody's favorite hockey mask serial killer shooting people and then getting shot in his anus.
But at one moment he wasn't there, and in the next, Jason was ominously present. Imposing, wrathful, hideous. His terrible features crowned by the strange majesty of a black welding mask. Even those who could not see through the tiny gaps in the cell doors felt his malignancy. In the student's cell, those who had previously come under his attack shuddered and breathed hard. Tina, who had never had to face him before, sobbed softly. Trey knew now that he was something more than just a creature of violence. Jason Voorhees had long since transcended his humanity. He was a death force, something not bound by normal human limitations. If violence was in the air, then Jason could appear out of the ether. If his filthy, murdering lackeys were present, then Jason was somewhere close at hand. And the response team fired at him, with the second line dropping to the crouching position in place of their fallen number. The first four hit him with everything they had. At least one of the shots hit home, tearing holes in his back jerkin. Jason was knocked back, but unbowed, unbeaten. 10 feet behind him, his feral shock troops cursed and sputtered with pain. Those shots that had barely left their mark on the masked man were ripping into their flesh, tearing them apart against the wall. Jason held his weapon high, a symbol of his intended triumph. It was no gore-encrusted blade, but something much more deadly, conjured out of recent memory. He extended the powerful semi-automatic hunting rifle from his shoulder, lining up the side against one eye. His obliterated vacant eye, which should have been blind. Then he fired. He opened up a rapid repeat fire fusillade, gunning down anyone in his path, hitting the guard's response team and a couple of prisoners released at the end of the corridor by humane guards, all too aware that they may be about to enter hell. Jason was no longer just a living, breathing vehicle for murder, a violence-crazed thing. He was a destructive crusader, and he was declaring war on all of America. But when the ammunition was exhausted, Jason stalked down the corridor and reverted to using his hands, to slashing and disemboweling with his long machete, to rending humans' forms apart by pulling a disarticulated arm or leg out of its socket. It was as the Crystal Lake Killer reverted to primitive violence that the Forest Green Posse made their break. Trey and Shauna had commandeered the massacred killer's rifles with only one or two rounds left each. Gary Nelson had bridled at that, but they told him to shut his mouth and run, relaying as many of the other kids as he could with him. The moment they chose was one of heartless opportunism. Voorhees had grabbed a demented vagrant who dared to emerge from his cell at the wrong time. As his mighty fist crushed the poor loser's teeth and jawbone, forcing them down his gullet so that he was choking on his own bones, Jerry and the other guys ran for it. The first of them made it past the behemoth, his attention centered on his victim. But they still had to clamber over dead and dying bodies, still had to push the door back against the mortal weight of the luckless few, to put several inches of wrought iron between themselves and Jason. Once another human form was reduced to mulch, Jason began to advance. He was within several feet of tearing their youthful bodies apart, then the pain tore into his backside. The man behind the black mask turned and roared out his wordless pain. "Gotcha, you bastard! I hope that hurts like hemorrhoids from hell!" Shauna had lined up the sights of her .22 to hit the man-monster straight in the anus. No expert marksman, the first shot hit wide beneath his crotch, while the second was directly on target. As he lunged towards Shauna, another trickle of Forest Greeners ran for their lives. His bulk moved at an alarmingly fast rate for one so ungraceful. "Step aside!" Trey fired off the only round that he knew he had left in his weapon. It hit Jason dead center in the pubic region. Jason squealed and raged, and Shauna ran. She was momentarily forgotten as the pain filled his fractured consciousness. His sexual organs were of no use to him. Long ago, the sensuality had been seared from his being. What was left in place of human warmth was a hatred for humanity that burned hotter than anything imaginable, except for the agonizing sting of hot lead in his genitals. The unearthly cry rang out as Shauna sprinted for freedom. As she slipped lightly below Jason's flailing hands, his maddened senses oblivious to all but pain. Trey was now the enemy writ large, the source of all confusion and all pain, the origin, in Jason's childlike mind, of all that had tormented and defeated him from day one of his existence. Trey passed through him, sweating and hyperventilating. His natural agility was heightened to an unnatural degree by his fear. The man-monster would soon assimilate its pain, as he had when Shauna had wounded him in the asshole. As he always had throughout his corrupted existence, from the time when the innocent child sank to the bottom of the lake and his twisted flesh began to rot. But, as Trey hit Jason in the wounded balls with the butt of his now unloaded rifle, the final pangs of that pain and confusion held him from responding effectively.
Well, while we're letting you all recover from that, or maybe just kind of mentally sift through that, let's go to another character. There's this intern, Christos, and I don't really know what his purpose is at a certain point, but then you find out that he's actually obsessed with Sanchez. So he wants to track him down and become his apprentice or something, but he gets help from this lawyer named North, and it turns out that North is actually the lawyer from hell. He changed his name and got a profession and he's now partners with the lawyer woman from the beginning of the book.
And being investigated by the feds, so...
Yeah, so where he got his credentials, how long has he been this lawyer? I mean, they say in the book that you can't tell time in hell, so it's hard to say how long they were in hell, how long it took them to get out of hell, and who arrived first, because it kind of implies that some of the killers got into Crystal Lake first. So how long has the lawyer been there? It sounds like he's been there for 9 months or so.
Yeah, I know. Maybe he conjured these things. Maybe he conjured his credentials. You know, like Jason conjured the rifle. It's possible.
It doesn't tell us.
Yeah. if Jason can conjure a rifle, yeah. And would you say that Wayne Sanchez is the main character of this book?
Man, I thought he was. He sure is the main character for the beginning of the book. Then they kind of forget about him. It's just like...
That's what I was getting to. Like, up to this point.
Once you get to Jason, you forget about Sanchez. And then when you're at Sanchez for so long, you forget about Jason.
Sanchez just goes to Florida.
He stays in Florida for the rest of the book.
Yeah, no, and it becomes more like the Christos and Sanchez road trip book. This book even comes equipped with some killbilly serial killers that escaped hell. And these are some creepy dudes, man. They try to lure... girls into their van. They're just so creepy and so sick. And they share a scene with Sanchez and with Christos. Christos actually rides with them, and that's a pretty fun scene. You know, when Christos is sizing him up and they're sizing him up, and that's the scene that leads to the welder's mask, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, but see, these characters. This would have been great if it was like a completely different book, because I feel like they could have explored the different killers. Like, maybe some of them could have found redemption, so when they die again, they don't go to hell. Like, maybe. I'm just spitballing here, but throwing in Jason, it was like the anchor that kept pulling this story down, because it was forced to hit certain milestones. Like, you got to mention the hockey mask. You have to mention this. I mean, hell, the lawyer, for absolutely no reason I can think of, brainwashes a teenage girl to become Jason's mom, and she
that's what leads to like the big showdown at the end of the book, or towards the end of the book, is the whole thing with this girl just hypnotized into becoming Pamela Voorhees out of nowhere. And you know what? hell with it. Let's this will be the last clip of the podcast. We still got plenty to talk about, but Gretchen becomes Pamela, and why? Because
the tried and trusted pharmaceuticals, he told Gretchen. Diane was all about aromatherapy and health store nerve tonics. But if Gretchen subjected herself to his methods, he promised her an easy ride. She was in safe hands. As he looked down on her reclining form, he wasn't so sure. It'd been a long time, but back when respectable Ed North was carefree Charlie Westenhaus, he'd developed quite a penchant for administrating sedatives to young women. Not always with their prior knowledge and permission, it had to be said. But he'd enjoyed some wild nights of abandon, whether his partner was conscious or not. Hypnotics like Rohypnol had been a fashionable accessory among rich and idle young men, and Charles had been among that vanguard. He looked at Gretchen's pert breast and defenseless body and wondered why it had to be so different now. He scares me, but he's so sad. He's like a big child. He's so terribly, terribly ugly, Gretchen began. But the ugliness isn't his fault. All the ugly things that ever happened in this world are manifest in Jason's flesh. When he showed me his face, it was like a child revealing to me his unhappy soul. No, he had to leave her alone. She was almost conscious. If that crazy babble she was coming out with could be called conscious. But it was partly what he wanted to hear. Since the girl had been complaining endlessly to Diane about her nightmares of Jason, North had become obsessed with knowing what she saw, with knowing whether that misbegotten freak was still as horribly powerful as he remembered, whether it was still in his power to inflict pain and destruction upon him. As Edward North, he now had a completely different life, but the Westenhaus element of his psyche, the part that remembered that purgatorial existence in the other world, was still afraid and still filled with hate. Jason suffers for the circumstances of his birth. He suffers for the deeds of others. When he commits atrocities, he only bears out what Mary Shelley's father said, "Treat a person ill and he will become wicked." This was becoming more than a little nauseating. "Tell me what you saw Jason do, Gretchen. Tell me about his power, his strength." "Jason did what he's been taught to do. Jason would never hurt a soul if it wasn't for the unkindness he's been shown. Jason kills because this world killed him first." Whoa, that was enough. The girl was freaking out now. She wasn't even speaking in her own light, measured tones anymore. This was the much huskier voice of a woman of about 50. He decided to bring her around with the dose of soluble caffeine before this got any further out of control. "My boy is a good boy at heart." North startled, mouth a wide range of profanities. She was hallucinating that she was the freak's mother. "He is a child. Just a child. Who would hurt a child? Who would persecute a babe in arms for striking out against those who hated and feared?" Shit, this had to stop. This had to stop now. He took a further step toward the girl to make her drink the caffeine solution. She rose suddenly from the couch, as if in an electrified reflex action. Her eyes opened wide and stared him in the face. Even her facial features seemed to have altered. There were wrinkles around the girl's previously unblemished eyes, and small lines around her mouth, the telltale signs of early middle age. "People like you, Charles Westenhaus, sneering no-goods like you, have persecuted my boy all his life." Now he really did feel nauseous. He drew back, searching to find where he had laid the hypodermic needle. "Go to hell," he snarled. "Whoever or whatever you are, just go to hell." His true voice showed again, since he no longer had a need to hide his identity. "If I go back to hell, I'm taking you with me, you evil mother-murdering bastard." Her face, mannequin-aged, howled at him. She had that one wrong, and he was about to show her just how wrong. If Jason Voorhees' crazy old bat mother was really inhabiting Gretchen Andrews' mind, then he was going to drive her out of there. She was the one who was going back to hell, even if it meant Gretchen had to depart this veil of tears, too. The girl's waving arms were manic, but not strong enough to fight him. When he got a tight hold of her right wrist, he was able to plunge the second syringe full of the truth drug straight into her arm. Almost immediately, the girl's mania left her. The intensity and natural disfigurement of age left her eyes, and she began to lose balance, to black out. North had no idea whether the two shots amounted to a potentially fatal overdose, but he would weather that storm if it came. He had played a fatally administrated injection as if it was an accident before, and he would do it again. But this time, his knowledge of the law wouldn't let him down. As he laid Gretchen's supine body on the couch, headlamps shone through the window of the office as the automatic gate of the garage raised into the air. No time for any further evasive tactics now, not even if she died.
There you go. She can be hypnotized and given a full history on somebody and know exactly how to act, just like that.
I feel like that's been our attitude with this whole book. Like, Jason, or Friday the 13th, Hell Lake, subtitle, to hell with it.
Because. But the biggest because comes I'm not going to say the very end because I wanted to touch on that too, but towards the end of the book, when everything's tied up, or at least it's attempting to tie up, I feel like the author could have went on longer, but he had to cut it short because a lot of character storylines don't get finished, especially North's. But this, the way to save the day is to get a generator, correct?
Oh, Sean? Spoiler alert.
we're spoiling this book, guys. But you should still listen to it just for the fun of it. But the way to open up a portal to hell, all you need is Crystal Lake and a generator. And you need to throw that generator into the lake and let it catch fire.
And supposedly killers from all over the country get sucked into the lake when the generator goes in. Like, all these characters, they had different arcs and different journeys. They all kind of end up in this blender.
No arcs. Those arcs are gone. Like, you don't find out. Like for instance, North had a pretty big story in this book. You know, this Christos character is such a little creep. We didn't really go into enough on him in the podcast because there's so much other stuff to talk about. But he has a story arc that ends up, he's like a big fan of Wayne Sanchez's. And you know how they say never meet your heroes? Well, he ends up meeting his hero, and I would say he got his just desserts in the end, the way it plays out. But you're right, man.
That way at all. So that definitely is a little journey.
But yeah, so Sanchez had this story going. North had this story going. But hey, once this generator gets thrown into Crystal Lake, fuck those stories, because it's time for fiery whirlwind of serial killers, you know, which I don't know what's going to stop them just from coming out of hell again the second they get back in there. Maybe the generator plugs the lake and the portal. Just imagine the people, like, just shopping at a store, driving in their car, you know, and like these serial killers are just flying through the air next to their car, getting sucked towards Crystal Lake, you know, that's going on everywhere.
I would think this ending, a way to fix it would be if they had tied in the prophecy movies where Christopher Walken is Gabriel, the fallen angel. That could have like been a way to explain how when they get sucked back into hell, that was their second chance and it's sealed or something. But
yeah,
you're in the book at the ending seeing that they could probably just come right back up again. Like, what's to stop them from coming right back out of that pit like they did the first time?
And you know, there's a couple other things that Jason does in this book that's way out of character. And a crazy epilogue that feels more like a Freddy movie than a Jason movie. And we're going to be discussing those things on After the Slash, the post show of this podcast, which is exclusive on Patreon. So if you want to check that out, head over to Patreon and support the channel. You can do it for as low as $2 per month, and you'll get access to the post show After the Slash. There's still a few crazy things about this book we're going to be discussing over there after we're done here. But man, Hell Lake. I wouldn't say it's the worst book I've ever read, but it is one of the craziest books I've ever read. Would you agree with that?
This book is like a wild ride, but it's that kind of wild ride for those carnivals they set up in like abandoned Walmart parking lots where you're on the ride and it's shaking and you're worried about the bolts that are coming loose. It's kind of a ride like that. But Death Moon is like when the ride breaks off completely and you sail through the air and you wonder about your life choices. That's Death Moon.
I quit complaining about Hell Lake after I read Death Moon. And I've had people ask me when they found out Death Moon's supposed to be bad, they're like, oh, is it like Hell Lake bad? And I'm like, no, Hell Lake is like the best book you ever read compared to Death Moon. That's going to be a fun episode. I really look forward to that one. You know, Sean, I had a chance to sit down with Joshua Adams. He's the producer, writer, and director of an upcoming fan film called Freddy vs. Jason Dreamscape. And apparently what they're doing with this movie is like giving us this the Freddy vs. Jason if they had actually just followed from Freddy's Dead and Jason Goes to Hell. And I got to talk to him for a minute, and I want to go ahead and play that real quick and let him explain their project and their fundraising they're doing. And I got to ask him his opinion on Hell Lake as well. Hello there. I was hoping you could tell everybody who you are and tell them a little bit about this fan film project
hey Josh,
that you're working
going?
On.
80/Librarian. This is Joshua Adams. I am the writer, producer, and the actor who will be portraying the role of Freddy Krueger in the upcoming fan film, Freddy vs. Jason Dreamscape. So thanks for having me on here. I guess to start off, the basic premise of the film is it's meant to be a direct sequel to Jason Goes to Hell and Freddy's Dead, since those films kind of came out back-to-back with each other. This film is meant to be kind of like the true sequel to Freddy vs. Jason, so it's not like a sequel to the Freddy vs. Jason that came out in 2003. It's actually meant to be the sequel that we feel we should have gotten back in the early 90s, when Rob Bottin, who was the special effects artist behind The Howling, The Thing, Total Recall, RoboCop, back when he was going to co-write and direct the film. That would have been back in 1997. And that movie was meant to be following off of the events of Jason Goes to Hell. So this film, it's bringing all the characters together, established characters from both franchises, and just giving the fans a real, like, hardcore, dark, scary, awesome event film. So that was kind of our plan there. And of course, the film will be directed and starring Cody Heskin, who will be playing the role of Jason in the film, and it's executive produced by Blake Best, who is a very well-respected author and just kind of all-around knowledgeable guy when it comes to the Nightmare on Elm Street franchise. He wrote Behind the Screams, Making a Nightmare 4 with Mick Strawn. And he also wrote The Within, and he wrote the novel, which is meant to be an official prequel to A Nightmare on Elm Street called Razor's Edge. Which is a fantastic novel.
Sounds awesome, man. I love that you guys are going to pick up where Freddy's Dead and Jason Goes to Hell leaves off. So if somebody wants to help fund this movie, how can they help out? Where can they go?
Is, I believe we're about 6 days left. We're sitting at just shy of 27% right now. We will actually be kickstarting a new one once this one's over, because the timing with this whole coronavirus and everything, the timing of it really slowed things down when it came to the like, we're still doing pretty good. The donations are still coming in almost daily, but compared to how it was just prior to this whole coronavirus thing, it was just happening really fast. Like, the donations were just rolling in. Fans were really excited. But then when the coronavirus thing hit and all that stuff and the stay-home order, it really slowed things down. So we will be doing another campaign not too long after this one is over. And Blake and Cody and myself have been constantly keeping everyone posted every day. Blake usually will have a new video out every day talking about it, so...
All right, man, thank you so much for coming on here. Really wish you the best of luck on your project. I'm looking forward to seeing it. I'm going to back it as much as I can. But before you go, we're discussing Friday the 13th, Hell Lake, the novel by Paul A. Woods in the Black Flame series. And I understand that you've read it or listened to it on the channel. And what is your take on Friday the 13th, Hell Lake?
So, thoughts on Hell Lake, Friday the 13th, Hell Lake, Black Flame. I know you enjoyed it as a horror novel. I think listening to it again, because I actually read it when it first came out. I used to have that book, and I read it in its original paperback form. And then I listened to it again through your audiobook on the /Librarian YouTube page channel, and there's certain things I liked about it. I liked the little references to, like, Forest Green, Jason Takes Manhattan. I liked the little subtle things they did there. I felt it definitely was kind of the author was having some fun sort of doing a little bit of that Of Mice and Men reference, where you have the really big kind of slow friend and the small interesting, because I don't really like talking negative about other people's stuff, like films and whatever. I mean, because I know they put a lot of effort into it. But I will have to say that as a Jason story, it definitely was lacking in a lot of those areas. It felt like it, I don't know, there was a lot of things about it that felt weird. And I know a lot of fans felt that way about it. I know that was kind of the one that most fans didn't like when it came to those books. Definitely Hate, Kill, Repeat. Church of the Divine Psychopath were probably, in my opinion, the best. Carnival of Maniacs was really good. Jason Strain was alright for the most part, though. I mean, I liked the fact that it had kind of like that Condemned feel, like the Steve Austin film. Except you throw Jason into the mix, I thought that was pretty clever. Ironically enough, the writers behind The Condemned, Rob Eden, is of course the guy who wrote and directed Jason Takes Manhattan, so I find it kind of ironic how he wrote the script for The Condemned, and then they wound up coming out with a Friday 13th novel, which had pretty much the same premise as The Condemned. So I thought that was really interesting how they kind of went full circle there. But I definitely have to say the what the hell moment, you know, that WTF moment with the fact that he's using a rifle as it's meant to be used, not as a blunt object. And the fact that they had him wear a welder's helmet instead of a hockey mask. I remember reading it and I'm like, what the hell? And yeah, but overall it's not horrible. I've read worse stories. But yeah, I mean, it's not bad. It's definitely different. I mean, I gotta give them props for that. They're trying to be different, I guess. But anyways, yeah, so thank you for having me on here and talk about this stuff. And hope you have a great day and stay safe out there. And remember, you know, a great word the Freddy once said, sleep kills.
All right, thanks a lot for coming on, man. And yeah, it is interesting about the whole Jason Strain Condemned thing. What's crazy is the Jason Strain was written like 4 or 5 years before The Condemned came out, you know, and the plots are so similar. So maybe that guy that you're talking about read the Jason Strain in 05 and then went on and wrote The Condemned and used that as his source material. We'll dive more into that, me and Sean will, whenever we cover the Jason Strain. So there you go, guys. Freddy vs. Jason Dreamscape. If you want to donate to the Indiegogo to help this film get made, the link is in the description below. Sounds like it's going to be pretty interesting, you know, taking the Freddy vs. or Jason Goes to Hell ending and Freddy's Dead ending and giving us like a Freddy vs. Jason based off of that instead of what we got with the 2003 film. What do you think of that?
Yeah, sounds good.
I'm always behind these fan films, man. A lot of passion goes into them, a lot of respect for the source material. So.
Yeah, because, I mean, all of these fan films, they do with a modest budget what these million-dollar movies can't do, because this is from the heart of the fans.
Never Hike Alone is, like, the best example.
Ooh, I can't wait for that sequel.
Oh, yeah, and Vengeance was great. I really enjoyed Vengeance. Having C.J. Graham in there as Elias Voorhees was pretty awesome. He got some pretty good kills. But before we start up After the Slash over on Patreon, let's have some final thoughts on Hell Lake here on Out of Print Slashers, man.
So Friday the 13th, Hell Lake, is kind of akin to Jason Goes to Hell, where it tries to do something different with the mythos. Jason's in hell, and he's surrounded by all the serial killers like him, and they lead a mass exodus out of hell. So the unsuspecting people in the regular world have to deal with all these killers that are coming back to life. So the people of Crystal Lake, now called Forest Green, have to band together to try to survive. So I guess this would be like the final level of Halo Reach, where the only objective is survive.
There you go.
That's it.
Hell Lake, to me, is one of the strangest Jason stories I've ever had the pleasure of reading. I did enjoy reading it. If you want to see something that's never been done with the Jason character before, whether you like it or whether it just goes too far in left field for you, this is the book to at least read or listen to on the channel. There will be a link in the description below, a link at the end of the video to take you to the unabridged audiobook of it. But there's going to be a lot of what-the-fuck moments in this book for you if you're a hardcore Jason fan. It's an experience worth having just to say that you've listened to the strangest Jason book ever written outside of Death Moon, which is Jason X. Shawn mentioned to me that I should have a shirt that said, "I read Hell Lake and survived," you know, or something like that. Might have to do that. But seriously, check it out. And once you listen to it, hit us up in the comment section and let us know what you thought of that book.
All right, so that about wraps up episode 4 of our podcast. I'm really enjoying getting into these.
Yeah, the next one, the votes were tallied up between Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. And for our next episode, we're going to be covering the novelization of Child's Play 2, which is kind of cool because the books we've covered so far have been books that I did back kind of in the beginning. But Child's Play 2 is one I just narrated last month. So that's going to be a lot of fun, I think. Episode 5, Child's Play 2, the novelization, is going to be our topic of discussion. I'm looking forward to that one. I hope you are too, Shawn.
Oh, absolutely. I'm actually in the middle of like rewatching the franchise because I didn't remember as much of Child's Play 2 as I thought I did.
Oh, it's one of my favorite horror sequels of all time. It and Halloween 2, the original Halloween 2. I think are both as good, if not better, than their original movies, especially Child's Play 2. I love Child's Play 1, but Part 2 took everything great about Part 1 and did it better. But yeah, guys, thank you so much for listening. Hope everybody's doing good out there and all this craziness, being stuck at home. Hope we brought you a little bit of entertainment, a little bit of fun. Like I said before, if you're not already a patron and you want to catch the after show, After the Slash show, then head on over to Patreon and sign up. You'll be supporting the channel and you get some cool rewards. You can even voice a character in an audiobook, depending on the tier. So thank you so much for listening. Shawn, thank you so much for being here with me. And until next time, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80 Slasher Librarian saying thanks for listening and pleasant dreams.
And the words of Jason, apparently, "Goddamn motherfuckers got blood all over my brand new welding helmet."